Well, very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you very much for coming out on such a dreary evening. Professor Haas uses novel techniques to turn a problem that occurs in radio communication into an LED light bulb mediated broadband wireless transmission system. Okay? So you can go now, actually, because I've done that bit. Fine. This is enormously significant. The presentation that he made at TED Global in 2011 has been watched so far by over 1.25 million viewers. Or I did wonder if it was 250,000 viewers who kept thinking, I'll get it next time. In 2010, he launched his own spin-out company, Pure VLC Limited. And in 2012, Time magazine identified this as one of the top 50 innovations in the world. We're delighted then that Professor Haas is going to give his Tam Dalyell Prize-winning lecture, My Li-Fi Revolution.
Thank you very much, Sue, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Can I take questions, please? Sue has said all about my talk today, so nothing for me to say. No, but I'm going to tell you a little bit today about Li-Fi and light fidelity that I coined in 2011. And first of all, I'd like to say that I'm greatly honored to be standing here to give the Tam Dalyell Prize lecture, which is a really great honor. So this combined with Li-Fi, I think hopefully makes a good mix for this evening. So the talk is about mobile communications, and please don't hope you don't mind if I walk around. I feel better if I wander around, give a lecture. It's about mobile communications. So we have 7.3 billion of these phones, smartphones, and this is more than the entire population on this planet. And they are so important, they are more important than perhaps electricity or water, like electricity and water. And they are a utility we use every day on Facebook, on Twitter, on email, on internet, on everything, so that perhaps we can live without electricity, but we can't live without mobile phones at the moment. And in fact, they are called smartphones, but I think this is not the right word for it. It's a personal computer. It's more like a computer. So that the success of these devices has caused a big problem. And I'd like to explain that problem here. Cisco, one of the major providers of communications equipment, has said that by 2018, there will be about 16 exabytes of data sent through our mobile networks. I'm sure you don't know what an exabyte is, some of you, me neither, so I had to look it up, but the number is there. But to put it into context, that is equivalent to 1.8 million years of high-definition video sent through mobile networks every month. I think that perhaps explains what the surge in terms of data volume in mobile networks is. And there's another trend that we see. We currently use mobile phones as the major wireless communication devices, but there's the so-called Internet of Everything. In the future, we have items, objects connected to the Internet. And that people forecast that by 2020, we have about 1,000 mobile devices connected or used by every person on the planet. So it's a surge in the number of devices, a surge in the data rate. And it's all using electromagnetic spectrum, in particular radio frequency spectrum, which is limited. There's another big problem that is caused by mobile networks. It's the energy consumption. I think Vodafone has to deal more with diesel than with its networks, and I explain you why. The entire energy consumption of mobile networks is equivalent to the entire global air traffic, and it's increasing. I've just heard recently at a conference in Italy, the mobile networks providers are the biggest energy consumer next to the rail line, the trains. So that's a problem. And how is mobile networks, how are they created? They use radio base stations like this one, a radio mast. And this is taken in Edinburgh over Craig Lockhart. And the reason why I've taken that is not by random. is many of these base stations, which consume about 3,000 watts, are still diesel-powered. And in fact, this is a diesel-powered base station in Edinburgh. And you may see it here. You may see this gray area here. This is the fume coming out of this green box, which is the base station. And that's the radio frequency equipment, and these are the antennas. But this is a diesel-powered base station in Edinburgh. And that's still around, and many of them, obviously, in developing countries. My vision is that in the future, we don't have so many radio base stations anymore. Instead, we have this. You recognize what that is? That's the innovative King's Buildings campus at University of Edinburgh. And this street lamp here is not an ordinary street lamp. It's an LED-based street lamp because the university wants to contribute to the reduction in CO2 emissions. And that's what these LED base stations or street lamps do. But in the future, I think we can turn an energy inefficient radio base station into a street lamp. Who of you knows this gentleman? This is Alexander Graham Bell. His father was professor at University of Edinburgh. He studied in Edinburgh before he went to Canada. Obviously, he stands for the telephone, the invention of the telephone. But interestingly, the telephone, he believed, wasn't his biggest invention. And I feel slightly awkward because I'm standing here talking about Li-Fi revolution when this guy has done it before in 1880. What he has invented was the photophone. And it was the most greenest, or the greenest communication system you could imagine. What he's taken sunlight coming on a mirror, and it's the sunlight is collimated, and then it's a microphone here, and the current induced by the voice changed the angle of the mirror. And these angular changes were recovered by a selenium cell 200 meters away from the transmitter, if you want, the sunlight transmitter. And this little selenium cell recovered the intensity changes of the sunlight because of the changing mirror. And this person could then listen to what the other person 200 meters away said. And that was invented 1880, the photophone. A guy that has its roots in Edinburgh. So, and he believed that this was his biggest invention, even bigger than a telephone. But it's obviously, there are natural problems if you are relying on sunlight for data communication, especially if you are in this country. Sometimes it's diluted by clouds. So there were sort of technical problems, but with the LED, the light-emitting diode, this can revive now into something what he thinks may appreciate a new communication system. Why is that important? I've mentioned the problem of the shortage of radio frequency spectrum. In order to see that, one has to go beyond or go out of the boxes to see what is the entire electromagnetic spectrum we have available for our wireless communication systems. And obviously, all commercial and all defense systems are operated between 0 and 1 here. This 1 means 10 gigahertz. All the systems operate in that range of spectrum. There are now people looking into higher ranges, called millimeter wave or terahertz communication. But there is this additional huge amount of visible light spectrum, which is sort of illuminating us. And that is, in fact, 10,000 times larger than the entire radio frequency spectrum we use for our communication system. And not only that, there comes a few more advantages with that. The radio frequency spectrum is limited, but there's also some existing concern about health issues. And this is a press release by the World Health Organization in 2011, where they claim or say that radio frequency spectrums can still, or radio frequency signals have the potential to be potentially carcinogenic. I need to say here very clearly, there's no scientific proof that this is the case. But the WHO still has this warning out. And if you run a school, if you run a public place, you need to be carefully watching what WHO says. And this is a mere fact. So there's limited spectrum, there's this potential of a health risk with no scientific proof. I need to repeat that very clearly. And then we have this 10,000 times larger amount of visible light spectrum. And since 2000, we see the mass deployment of high brightness white LEDs, LED illumination, LED light bulbs we see in our houses, in our cars, in our street lights, everywhere. And they produce that spectrum that we can use for data communication. So far, we haven't been able to utilize it because the incandescent light bulb is too slow to react to intensity changes because of the wire that's heated up. But this is an electronic device, an LED, and that could change very rapidly. So there's electronics already inside these light bulbs. So we would fit another chip, another microchip, a Li-Fi chip, and turn that light bulb into a high-speed broadband communication device. The advantages are summarized here. It's using unregulated spectrum, 10,000 times larger than the entire radio frequency spectrum. So no government has yet issued any licensing on that spectrum. It's huge and it's safe, it's visible light. Light has created life on this planet, so there's arguably no danger. And the good thing is that what I've tried to explain with the street lamp, we can exploit existing infrastructure, our street lamps, our home lighting systems, our cars, all our infrastructure where we have lights connected to can be used in order to distribute data to the light sources. And not only that, these LEDs have now come down in prices significantly. An LED light costs not more than £1 to £3. So that's the driving force behind Li-Fi. So how does it work, so you may ask? As I tried to already alluded to, the data is encoded in the intensity. And it's a bit like this. So we want to convey binary zeros and binary ones. This is how all our digital data is represented at the moment. And the way we convey a logical one would be we turn on the light. When we want to transmit a logical zero, we would turn it off. It's a bit like you know, these bike lights. It's an LED light. Turn on, turn off. So on is one, zero is, off is zero. This is how I can transmit ones and zeros. And I believe people at the back of this room can see the flashing light, right? So this means if your eye can see it, if you have a photo detector there, you would be able to recognize ones and zeros. So I could transmit that over very long distances if I wanted to. The way we do it is not as slow as this. Much, much faster. It's about 10 or 100 million times per second we turn it on and off. Human eye won't recognize the flicker. But a photo detector, which is an electronic device, would be able to follow these changes and then recover the data stream. That's the simplest way of viewing how you would be able to transmit data, digital data, with a light bulb like this. Can I have a little request for a little bit of water? Is that right? So that's the way we would do it. So then you would wonder, how would a receiver look like? So that a receiver, we have developed in one of our research projects, a receiver which are photodiodes. Photodiodes are photosensitive semiconductors. And this is the first Li-Fi receiver chip that has in total 49 photodiodes integrated. You don't see it. The size of that chip is about 2.8 by 2.8 millimeters. And within this space, we have 49 receiver elements. Compare that against a smartphone, an iPhone antenna, which is a single antenna that occupies 20 times more space. It's 60 millimeters. So much, much larger. So we can basically integrate this into very tiny units because light is, the wavelength is so small. And what we can do with that, with a receiver like this, we can imitate nature as well. If we would create a semisphere of receivers that are sort of split or placed around an element like here, we could imitate facet eyes of an insect. So that means we can take the light from that direction, which is our signal, and then we can see light is coming from that direction, which may be interfering signal, and we can be blinding that link and can focus on with one eye or with one facet on the direction where our sending device sends the signal. So that's something that we can do with these very small photodiodes. Now, you would perhaps say, that's all good, and we've seen that. We have it at home. If I turn on my TV and I switch the channels, I have a remote control. A remote control like this, and a TV here, and I control the TV with my infrared, which is also part of light, infrared light, control the TV. Very low rate data stream. That's not sufficient to have broadband communication. So that's where I have to make a big leap, because what we have done is we have developed algorithms that turn a light bulb into a device that sends not only one data stream, it sends thousands of data streams in parallel at very high speeds, higher speeds. And that's why we can increase the data rates by orders of magnitude. And that's the research bit that I've been doing for now 10 years in order to turn these light bulbs into high-speed transmitters. So a bit of history. I've just mentioned that I started I've been doing this for 10 years. In fact, I started 2003 when I was at a university in Germany, Jacobs University in Bremen, where we had first experiments where I was trying to turn a disadvantage of an algorithm that is used in radio frequency into an advantage for visible light communication. We never knew whether it works, but with a student who is now also the VP of engineering in my company, we showed that using a particular algorithm, it is possible to enhance the data rates. And the first demonstration we have done in 2006 at a prestigious conference in Germany, it's called the Highlights der Physik. I think I don't need to translate what it means. And we have at that time taken an IKEA lamp, have removed the light bulb and have fitted in our own LED-based light bulb, and then have the electronics here that are connected to the light bulb and have a receiver here. And the receiver also is connected to some piece of electronics, and the electronics here send pictures to that screen here. So we were able to send pictures via a desk lamp like this. And that was sort of our first demonstration in 2006. Then there was, in Germany, the German government has initiated or asked a group of high-level scientists, the leaders of Fraunhofer's, Max Planck, Helmholtz, to go around into German labs and see what could transform our everyday lives within the next 100 years. And they have asked this guy here, the Autor Hensch. Hensch got a Nobel Prize in physics in 2005, so he's joining this university with Higgs in 2005, getting the Nobel Prize. And he has written that into a book, and he has shown these 100 ideas that can transform our everyday lives. And that is something where this, they called it sprechendes Licht, so speaking lights, where they covered it in this book. So that was a recognition we've received in 2007. And that's the time when I came to Edinburgh, and when I came here, I started to apply for research projects, and I was made aware of Scottish Enterprise and their concepts of proof of concepts. So I applied for a proof of concept project at Scottish Enterprise. The project was called the D-Light, D-Light, or D-Light. And that ended up in a demonstrator that you see in that gray box here, where I demonstrated 2011 Li-Fi to the TED audience with, again, a desk lamp like this, but now not with still images, but we've now sent a full video stream from that LED-based desk lamp and on a big screen behind me. That's where we shown it for the first time in public, that we can have real-time video streaming via an off-the-shelf LED light bulb. As a result of that, I've spun out this company that we initially called Pure VLC, but we changed the name of the company last year into Pure Li-Fi. And Pure Li-Fi has produced a bidirectional communication system with an off-the-shelf LED light bulb here and a modem here and a receiver here. And you see these units on the table, and I'm going to demonstrate it to you later to send a video from this kit here on the table. So this is where we are in terms of from an idea to commercialization, and Pure Li-Fi is at the leading edge of that commercialization. One thing we have to see, so far I've talked about a communication link between a transmitter and a receiver. But if you think of communication systems, we have a radio base station that would serve many users, right? It would serve many hundreds of users in the vicinity of a base station, and many of these users can talk to the base station. So it's a point-to-multipoint communication and a multi-point-to-point communication. The company that I've spun out is the first company that has produced, is going to produce a unit that allows you, or allows the unit to serve multiple desktops, multiple users in a room. And that's something unique. It's equivalent to what we see in Wi-Fi. It would also allow a user to roam within a building, to move from one edge of the room into another edge of the room, being served by different light bulbs, and the session would not be terminated. It would be carried over. We call it handover. It would be handovered from one light bulb to another one. And that is what we are working on at the moment. Fully networked Li-Fi. So the vision in the future is that we have a room like this, or a boardroom like this, where we have many light fixtures around, and every single light fixture would cover a certain area. So that sitting here would be covered by that light fixture here, and the people in that corner would be covered by that light fixture. What we can do with that is we would spatially reuse the light spectrum many, many times in a room. Imagine of a room that is equipped with a Wi-Fi router here. You would only be able to install one Wi-Fi router in that room. If you would install another one, they would interfere with each other. They would contend for spectrum. And that would bring down the throughput tremendously. But here, because the light is very confined spatially, we can have new systems that reuse the light more often in a room. And that leads to tremendous changes in terms of the data rate that a user would perceive. So the vision we put forward is, and that's very clear, is Li-Fi is not going to replace radio frequency systems. Not at all. It would be stupid. In fact, it would be an addition. So our vision is that we have radio base stations still outside. It would be serving users that move in street canyons, in rural areas, in woods, in forests, would be served by radio base stations because there is no light there. then if a user would enter a house, a room, an office, a university, it would be covered by a Wi-Fi router, or what we call femtocell, inside the building, so that the signal would be handed over from outside to inside. And it's no point in being served by a radio base station, because the signals from the radio base stations would have to go through all the walls. And every wall attenuates the signal by 15 to 20 dB, so by a factor of 100, roughly. And that is not energy efficient, I must say. And then if the user then enters a room that has light fixtures, and these light fixtures would then be able to provide these tremendous fat data pipes to the user. And this user would then be carrying the data from the light bulb, so another user would be able to use the radio frequency spectrum. We talk about RF relief, spectrum relief. So the less users that use RF, the more chances you give the new users that come and want to use that spectrum. So that's the vision we put forward. And we call this a macrocellular system. This is indoors is a pico and femtocellular system, and that system here we call next smaller unit is an atto. So it's an atto cell system. So this is the only graph, the only sort of more scientific bit I'm going to demonstrate and use to this evening. So we have in our cellular communication systems, we have macrocells, we have picocells, we have femtocells or Wi-Fi, and then we have another layer of cells, which are the light bulbs we call atto cell network. Now we have compared what would happen if we would equip offices and homes with Wi-Fi atto cells. What is the amount of data or the data rate we would enhance per square meter with that system? And I just want to show you the numbers here. This is the enhancement of data rate per unit area we would get with such an Wi-Fi atto-cellular network. Depending on the number of radio frequency base stations or femtocells you would have in that building. But the important thing is that it can go up to 900 or 1,000. So if you, in your room, get 1 megabit per second, now with your Wi-Fi system, you would get 1,000 times more than that. So it's 1 gigabit per second would be possible with Wi-Fi per square meter. So 1 megabit is, yeah, you can sort of browse the internet and so on, but it's very slow. But imagine what would happen if you would have 1 gigabit. Sending a video in that case would take seconds, 15 seconds. In the other case, 15 minutes. So it's a matter of speeding up your data communication. That's possible with this additional layer we are proposing. So this is what we are seeing as a vision into the future cellular network deployment. But there's also underlying research in my lab, and we've recently achieved basically two records in terms of data rate and coverage. So we use these little devices here from our collaborators at Strathclyde University. They are called micro-LEDs. These are very tiny little LEDs, have very low output power, 5 milliwatts. And you see that micro-LED here and a receiver at this end here. This is a bench and the distance is 1 meter. So what we've done in that experiment with our modulation algorithms and modulation techniques, we have achieved 3.5 gigabit per second from that 5 milliwatt micro-LED. So the very latest Wi-Fi standard is saying they would achieve roughly 7 gigabit per second, but in practice, 1 gigabit per second. And with this, we can achieve 3.5 gigabit with one color. Now imagine what would happen if you blend red, green, and blue. You have three color streams. 3 times 3.5 is beyond 10 gigabit. So we can achieve a 10 gigabit per second light bulb in the future, and that's what we're working on. And not only that, people always say, what about coverage? What about distance? And I've tried to demonstrate that with my flashing light. That's really relatively easy to cover long distances. But we have achieved 1.1 gigabit with that little tiny LED over 10 meters. And it's limited to 10 meters because, sadly, the lab isn't longer than this. So it is really possible to have long distances. And if you imagine car headlights and so on, it is sort of highly capable. And you see the 3.0 gigabit, you see the sine wave here that is coming from that detector here. It's still recovering the signals. So this is the this division. So the main ideas behind Li-Fi. And I've at the moment limited my view and my vision towards cellular communication, enhancing data rates, enhancing speeds. But this is by far not the end of the story. I'd like to explain to you what can be done with light-enabled communication. And this is with a number of pictures I've shown here. One is the street lamp. I've tried to explain it with the LED street lamp on university campus. We have many street lamps in a city. And every street lamp can be equipped as a Li-Fi transmitter serving multiple users, and multiple users talk to the light bulb, to the street lamp. It's really the same as a standard cellular communication system. It's possible. We have the opportunity with the LED-enabled headlights and LED-enabled car backlights to develop completely new intelligent transport systems where cars can talk to each other. And the cars could react faster when they are Li-Fi enabled for using, for example, anti-collision systems, where the brake light would communicate back to the car behind, and the system would be enabled, activated, that would then react and brake before an accident would happen. The car lights could talk to street lamps or traffic lights. So traffic lights could talk to cars, not only sort of turning on and turning off, but also provide ad hoc, real-time traffic information at that corner where the street lamp is, the traffic light is. If I go here, radio frequency signals don't propagate underwater. It's salty, it's conductive, but light does. If you imagine remote operated vehicles, they scan the seabeds looking for new oil reserves, and they take photos from the seabed, but these photos need to be transmitted to the surface, and lights can be used to do that. Or these remote operated vehicles can exchange images via their lights that illuminate the seabeds. Divers could use their torches to talk to each other. At the moment, there's no good way that the divers can communicate, but torches can be the transmitter, and there's photo detectors integrated that would make a full two-way communication system. And then this is a kettle here. I would like to illustrate to you that kettles and many of our home appliances have LEDs integrated, status lights. These lights can be turned into high-speed transmitters. So you can hook up your kettle to the internet. You could hook up your fridge with the status light to the internet. So while you're on Tenerife, you could see the mold growing in your fridge stream to you at high definition quality. That's all possible. But you laugh. The applications are hopefully more intelligent. For example, enabling more intelligent energy handling. So more intelligent sleep modes with these lights to reduce the energy consumption. 10% of the entire energy consumption at home is domestic. And if we use lights like this in order to have more intelligent energy management, it would make big, big savings. And then, I don't know if you see that at the back, this is a lady with an earring that is illuminated with an LED, a tiny micro LED. So that earring could in fact be a transmitter transmitting sugar levels, temperature, all sorts of medical data, monitoring data online, real time, to a receiver at a light bulb. It's not using RF, it's using light. And in addition to that, it also seemingly looks nice. And then what is also possible now is indoor navigation. We all use our sat-navs on streets, but if you go to an airport, into a shopping mall, into a hospital, you often are lost. don't know where to go. But now imagine you have these LED lights at the corridors. There's one here, there's one there, 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 there's a light, there's a light. And these lights illuminate sort of confined, spatially confined. So the lights can broadcast an identifier, a token, if you want. And if you, with your mobile phone, walk under that light fixture, you will be able to receive the token, and the token would be linked to the location where the token is sent. So the mobile station could make sense of where the user is within that building, and you can have new ways of indoor navigation. That's possible with light. Shopping windows. So we have seen today a very nice illustration about augmented reality, where there's been a very great project being done, mapping sort of images that you see into bigger context. You take an image of this beautiful place here, and then you get additional information about the history. Now, if you take a shopping window like this, where the shopping window has sort of LED lights that illuminate the items on display, and then the lights can also provide coupons, information about the objects on sale. So basically, you could pull in customers in a totally different way by providing additional information in the shop. So it's basically blending high street shopping with online shopping. You do online shopping while you're on the high street. Yeah, it's merging the two concepts. And then one of my favorites is variables. This is a nice skirt illuminated, so LED is integrated, and these tiny LEDs can be integrated. So there's entirely new ways of having objects like clothes being hooked up to the internet. Not sure what to do with it, but it's possible. And then museums. So we'll be talking to the director of the Copenhagen Glyptothek soon, where they have raised significant interest in using light communication in a museum context, because you have lights that would illuminate the objects on display. And these lights would then be able to provide additional information about the history, about all sorts of information you couldn't be having sort of in a larger context on a piece of paper. And that would be possible. Another great application is intrinsically safe environments, like petrochemical plants or petrol stations, where you often see the crossed out handy symbol, or sorry, crossed out mobile symbol. And that is because the antenna could create electric sparks and it could cause explosions. But lights don't use antennas, so you can't create a spark. And therefore, lights can be used in petrochemical plants, in petrol station oil platforms, and so on. So it's a new way of creating more secure systems, wireless communication systems in these environments. And this is where we started the research. I've been doing research with one of the biggest aircraft manufacturers in Europe. It's an ideal use case, light communication inside an aircraft, where you typically don't use your mobile phones. But there's plenty of lights, headlights, illuminating lights in an aircraft that could provide you with internet access if the plane is hooked up via satellite link to the ground. So we have done very intensive research with this aircraft manufacturer. And here's an example of what kind of research we've done. You see a similar image like this, an aircraft cabin where there are lights behind the overhead lockers, and there are lights in that ceiling units here. And what we have done is we have tried to find out what are the light levels at different regions inside the aircraft cabin. And this is a picture that depicts the light levels with different colors. So red means very high light level, blue means very low light level. And the important thing is that the applications are manifold in an aircraft cabin. It's for in entertainment. It's one application, but that is an application where the aircraft manufacturers are not really so excited, because this will be delivered anyway by an external party. The interesting application for an aircraft manufacturer is to make these aircrafts more modular. And they don't want to have these seats to be wired up to a particular location in the cabin. The seats should be flexible. It should be movable. And also, we know from the A380, there was a big problem with the wiring initially. The wiring is very heavy. It's a lot of copper, and it produces a lot of weight. And in order to save CO2 emissions, weight has to be going down, and therefore copper is not seen very well in aircraft. So they want to have many systems inside an aircraft that communicate wirelessly rather than via copper cables. And that's why we have done these ray tracing simulations. Basically, we trace the ray, the light ray, and you see these blue areas where there's little light, and there's little light here under the seat. But interestingly, that research showed that although the color is blue here, the color is blue here, 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 that doesn't mean that there is no way of communicating to that point. So it would be possible to take this light at the ceiling to communicate even to a location under the seat. And that's one of the key findings, and that's one of the misconceptions I will mention later. LIFAR is not a line-of-sight technology. It also works in non-line-of-sight environments. Here's another example of a current research project we are doing within the oil and gas industry. I've been told that in the gas industry, so this is a project we were doing, that there's a need for maintenance. And every 6 months, the gas well need to be maintained. They need to be tested if the temperatures are right, the pressure is right. A lot of telemetry data are to be measured. And that takes a few days for a company to come in and let cables down the gas well in order to measure the parameters down there. And that costs $200,000, I've been told. And the oil and gas industry want to have a real-time, all-time monitoring of the well metrics there. And we've been studying that, and we've been proposing a visible light system. And this is a pipe that is 4,000 meters long, 4 kilometers long. And we have shown that it is possible to have a light source at the well, which is not an antenna, so there's no problem about electric sparks or explosions. And have a receiver at the surface, we can have a real-time visible light communications monitoring system installed in a gas pipe like this. And now we are running into a project where we would like to do more measurements and also a real demonstration in a real-life environment. Another example, security. Security is a big issue at the moment in media, cybersecurity. If you open up your phone or your laptop and you want to go to the Edinburgh airport, you want to hook up to a Wi-Fi network, how many Wi-Fi networks do you typically see on your screen? 10, 15, 20? That means you receive the signals from Wi-Fi access points, different operators, different providers. And if you are an Edinburgh informatics student, you have the skills to perhaps break the security and break into other networks. There's smartness required, but it is not impossible to break into Wi-Fi networks. We have seen that, and that's been in the news. Now, let's take that back and see what would happen if you have a Li-Fi system. So what I'm showing here is a house, a building, and here are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 Wi-Fi networks that you would see on your smartphone. So what would happen if you would take Li-Fi instead? It would look like this. If your Li-Fi network is installed in that room here, separated by concrete walls, you would not see any Li-Fi network, simply because the wall would prevent the light to go through. Radio signals go through walls, but light doesn't. That provides an enormous and powerful mechanism to create much more secure wireless systems. Now, I would like to come back to slightly different. Now, this is really cutting-edge research we've been doing the last 3 months or so. So we thought we could do the same with a solar cell that we have done with a light bulb. So the light bulb is a emitter of light, and we have encoded data on that light emitter. Now, would it be possible, would it be nice to take the opposite of a light emitter, namely a solar cell? And can a solar cell be used as a receiver of a broadband Li-Fi data stream? That was our hypothesis. So we are not experts on solar cells. So what we've done is we've gone to a website and bought a solar cell. You see it here. It's an off-the-shelf solar cell. But we have our modulation techniques, and we have used that, and have the modulated light source here. It's a modulated torch, LED torch, that is pointing to the solar cells, and it has encoded information encoded in the intensity. And interesting, what we found out is via an off-the-shelf, unmodified solar cell, we can send 7 megabit of data. A 7 megabit data stream can be recovered by a solar cell. And that's not yet optimized. Now, if we want to talk to now people who develop solar cells, and there's many people that ask, what about the sunlight? Does it impinge on your communication? I always said sunlight is constant light. We eliminate, we filter it out. That's what we can do, because our information stream is encoded in light intensity changes. But maybe this was the wrong answer. The right answer would be now, the ambient sunlight is something we use constructively to power our Li-Fi receiver. So we could have an autonomous self-powered Li-Fi transceiver where the constant sunlight provides the energy. So what can we do with that? So here are a few examples of typical applications we foresee. We have many remote areas in locations where there is no LTE, there is no broadband communication. What we have is, what exists are so-called free space optical communication systems where there's 8 light beams or light beams sent over kilometers of distance to a receiver, where this is the receiver, this is a big circular element, a big lens that would take that sort of confined collimated light beam and would recover the data signal. That's what exists at the moment. But the problem is that the distance is very large and the area of the receiver here is very small. The problem is then, if there is wind and there is changes in angles, so slight angular misalignment of a communication system like this would mean that the light beam sometimes misses the target. And it's really hard to align the transmitter with the receiver. But now imagine you have a solar cell on your roof and you point your light beam roughly to that roof of a hut in the Highlands. The solar cells would basically power the transceiver and would be the receiver of that data stream. So it's relatively easy to have a long-range communication system, and providing long-range high-speed data to remote areas is possible now. That's one application. The other application is you would take your smartphone, have an OLED device, and have a solar cell integrated into the display of your smartphone. And that solar cell would power the device or help powering the device, but it also would be the receiver of your Li-Fi systems, Li-Fi signals. And then modern solar cells are bendable, they are flexible. And that would mean that if you take a flexible solar cell in a micro LED, which is shown here, probably you don't see, this is about 1 or 2 millimeters big LED. Now you could have a self-powered transceiver, which is a little foldable display and an LED that you can stuck everywhere, capturing all sorts of information, temperatures, pressures, telemetry data. Many different signals can be measured and transmitted via a unit like this. Another application is, imagine you have a Wi-Fi access point. You always need 2 cables of a Wi-Fi access point, right? One is the data cable and one is the power cable. Now let's assume you can throw away the data cable and the power cable, that you power your Wi-Fi access point via a light link and a solar cell that is integrated, and at the same time, provide data via that link. That means you can stuck your Wi-Fi access point everywhere where you need it. And you can shut it off by turning off the light. Now, if you take this as an example, wallpaper in the future can be made of solar cells. Your wallpaper could be your Wi-Fi transceiver and transmitter router in the future. So it's getting late. What I've tried to work on is to tell you that Li-Fi is one idea, but the implications are manifold. And the applications range from novel devices, novel components, to entire networking and protocols and communication systems. And I don't go into the details in between, but there are different layers, and every layer is an expert. So we have at least 10 different experts we need to put together, bring together, to develop complete working full systems. And then we have that across different application areas. Underwater, space, we haven't even talked about satellite communication, and then terrestrial, and we talk indoor terrestrial and outdoor terrestrial. These are different angles. If you take that all together, you see that there's a big implication, industrial-wise. And this is discovered not by us, but by an independent research institute, Markets and Markets, where they have identified, they have seen these different applications of light communication for indoor networking, location-based services, intelligent transport systems, underwater, and that these systems will come within the next 3 years. And there are others like ubiquitous computing, machine-to-machine communication, like what I talked about, cars, smart cities and wireless sensor networks with the idea of sticking sensors everywhere, and that will come within the next 10 years. And every of these bubbles is at least one company. And that's why we talk about a Li-Fi industry. And again, the market analysis here has looked at what is the market value of Li-Fi, or visible light, in 2018. And they come to the conclusion it's about $6 billion, spread across different markets, North America, Europe, Asia Pacific, rest of the world. But that's a huge industry. It is not existent. But we are at the heart of it. So basically, we are seeding it. And there's a big, big opportunity here. And that's why I'm very glad and pleased that we have not only a very successful spin-out company here, Pure Li-Fi, we are going to address that in a larger scale with the help of the university, where we have recently created the Li-Fi R&D Center. And we hope that we will have stakeholders in that center like the university, like public entities, like strategic industrial partners, and obviously across different schools. And it's a classic example about a center that works across different schools, because you need the communications protocols in informatics, you need the microchips developed in informatics and engineering, you need chemistry to develop new materials for LEDs, you need physics in order to develop new optical systems, and you need the business school. Why? Because that is disruptive technology. We use free spectrum, unlicensed spectrum, FAT-free pipes, data pipes. That disrupts business models. That's why the center needs to work with the business school in order to address that issue. And then we have different areas like components, optical subsystems and systems, and then different applications that I've mentioned. I haven't mentioned health. I'd like to take this as an outgoing remark. But we have smart environments, 5G, underwater, and there are new applications that come in, others go out, and that's the way we keep it sustainable. There's always a new application that will come up, will be phased into the center, and some will phase out, and that's the sustainability bit. And then we deliver patents, collaborations, new industry. That's the most important thing, new industry in Scotland. And for this, we need strong support. And one of the industry creation is something that I've built up here, and you've seen it in a diagram before, is that what we call Li-First unit. That is basically what you see here is an off-the-shelf light fixture. It's an off-the-shelf LED light fixture This wasn't created for the purpose of communication. That's not our business. This unit here is a transceiver unit, the modem, that is connected to the internet, or in our case, to a laptop that streams a video to that box here, to that gray box. And that gray box is linked by a cable to the light source. The gray box provides power to the light and data. Right? And the green lamp here, you see, the green status lamp says that there's an established link to the unit that you see on that end here. There's the receiving unit. There's a red blinking light. You may see that. That means that at that end, the link is not established because the light isn't on. But what we have is here that the blue center bit is the receiver, the photodetector, with a filter on top. And then you see these white spots. Do you see these white spots in the middle? These are LED lights, but not visible light. This is infrared. So we have an infrared link from that unit, which is the desktop unit, to that ceiling unit. And that's why the status light is green. That's an already established link. And that's why we have a bi-directional communication system, so we can serve the internet. That's what you need for internet serving. You need to send requests and receive. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on that light. So see what happens. So you see a video, and that video is transmitted from that light, ceiling light. So you may not believe me, but I could break it. It would stop. So the video is transmitted via this unmodified light fixture. So I'm doing a bit of an experiment. So we are pointing that light directly into the receiver. But the question is, would it work if we turn it around? The video still goes.
Why?
Why? Because we have a non-line of sight technology. We have covered this with a white blanket, and that reflects the light. And the photons that are emitted, these light beams, are reflected from that wall, from that piece of cotton. And the receiver is so sensitive that it would take all the reflective light. So this is what can be done. So what I can do is now I can be ambitious to also try to dim down the lights. Can we go a bit down? See, I've dimmed the light. The video is still going.
Still bright.
Yes, bright. But still, the video is sent through the light fixture. So imagine this. I'm going back. That is normal because the system needs to. What I've done is I've done a very crude change of the intensity. So there's algorithms that need to go on in order to stabilize the light, the stream. Once it's stabilized, it runs. So it's possible to, the main point here is it is possible to take off-the-shelf unmodified light fixtures and turn them into high-speed data communication devices. Right. So this is the demonstration that I wanted to show it to you, and let's go further with a bit of a misconception I have received over the last few years about Li-Fi. One of the misconceptions is that lights cannot be dimmed. Agree, I haven't dimmed it to levels we could dim it because there's a very coarse dimming control in our system. But the algorithms we have developed is we can go down to levels that light would be off, and it would still emit photons that would carry the information. That's possible. the lights flicker. Do the lights flicker? No, because the rate of change is so fast that a human eye can't recognize any changes in intensity here, but that receiver can. Is it for downlink only? No, it's not, because I've shown here one system that is downlink from the light to the bottom, from the bottom to the light via infrared. What about interference from sunlight? Sunlight is constant light that is filtered out. But as I said earlier, now we have even more advanced technology where we can make use, sensible use of sunlight in energy harvesting. And lights need to be on all the time. Is that not inefficient in terms of energy consumption? Yes, but if you can turn them down, and in addition, these are LED lights, they will still require less power than an RF system. I've shown you with a 5 milliwatt LED, it is possible to cover 1 meter at 3.5 gigabit per second. And is this line of sight technology? No, it is not. And I've tried to give a little proof today by turning around the light and having it run from reflective surfaces. That brings me slowly but surely to the end of my talk with some concluding remarks. I hope I have convinced you that Li-Fi has the power and the potential to create an entire new industry, not only one spin-out company, but many. Li-Fi can be used essentially everywhere where there is light, especially LED light. And the range of applications for me is not imaginable at the moment. And there's one particular area where I have a particular research interest I would like to go in, is for health. I would like to study and see what would happen if you implant micro-LEDs or micro-LED-powered transceivers into the body of a human. Light would basically go through the tissue, go through the body. And it's safer than radio frequency signals. It wouldn't interfere with a pacemaker. Can you measure vital data so to enable patients to stay at home, rather go stay at hospital a long time, where you have a real-time monitoring, health monitoring system? And I want to even go further than this, is would it be possible to do some research where you can mend broken nerves via a Li-Fi link? So enable people to go around sort of disabilities like this. That's not studied. It's only I'm giving you my desire where I'd like to go into the future with Li-Fi. To bring it to a final summary is, I hope you agree that Li-Fi is a greener, can provide a greener, a healthier, and a safer future. In addition, because we have so many fat pipes, data pipes, which are free, unlicensed, that we have almost unlimited wireless data in the future to provide, label all the growth of wealth and new services in that modern world. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Haas. It's not often you get a glimpse of the future, less often that it's an optimistic glimpse of the future, but I think that's what we've had tonight. I really look forward to be able to leave my kettle attached to the internet when I go on holiday, but I would have to point out, as a senior member of the University of Edinburgh, that our informatics students don't break into other people's wireless networks, at least not using university systems. I just need to give you an update on what's going to happen for the next few minutes. In a moment, I'll give you an opportunity to ask some questions of Professor Haas. I'm sure you have many that you would like him to answer. And when we come to do that, I'd ask you to be patient while we bring a microphone to you so that we can record your question as well as the answer that Professor Haas gives us. At the end of that, I'll ask Dr. Dalyell to come up and give the prize to Professor Haas. And after that, we'd invite you all to stay and have some drinks with us. We have soft drinks and wine at the back of the hall, and the opportunity to explore these augmented reality apps that the university is devising. We want them to be ready for our students at graduation in May and June, and we'd like you to be our guinea pigs. So if you haven't already tried them out, they're available at the end of the talk for you to explore. So have you got any questions that you would like to ask Professor Haas? First one here. Can we have a microphone? Two ladies in red are running towards you as you pause.
I have two questions, one short one. The photophone by Bell, did it actually work?
Yes. Yes.
And the second one, what about security when you are in the room? Like hacking or transmitting false data?
Hacking, you mean that the man in the middle, the eavesdropper? The LEDs have a cone, sort of like a cone of light that points upwards or downwards. And you have to be within that cone in order to intercept. That's an additional layer of security you would add. So the man in the middle, the eavesdropper, you would see him or her. And you could ask her, can you please not listen to my
But if you had comments? A little microchip that that you'd smuggled in or something.
But you would see it, but it's a level of security that could be there, but it's a very, very thin, sort of spatially contained light beam that is really hard to intercept.
Good. More questions? Hands up, and we'll bring a microphone to you over there.
How many different centres of research are there in the world on this, and is Edinburgh one of the leading ones?
So you ask how many research groups in the world? As I said to you, I've started 2003, and I at that time was among another group in Japan, the only two groups working on visible light communication. Since then, especially after my TED talk, there's been tremendous worldwide research interest. And I'm slightly worried about the pace and the level of investment that goes into China. And there's been recent news about new developments where they have essentially duplicated a system we've shown at TED and trying to commercialize. So yes, there's in America, there's in Europe, in France, in Germany, in China, in Korea, in Japan. But in terms of these headline figures, these are world records, as far as I know at the moment. So we are, and with a company Pure Life, I have spun out where we have commercialized the world's first bi-directional communication link. No one else has done this, and we're selling it into security industry in the States for a moment. So we are still leading the edge, but I'm worried about the level of finances. If you can only do so much, there's more in the brain than you have in your pockets. And that's my worry. So that, especially with China. But we do our best in order to keep up the race and winning the race. And in fact, if we, the 6 billion, if 1 billion goes to China, wouldn't be so much worried, as long as the 5 stay here.
There's another question over on the left.
Professor Haas, I'd like to thank you for a fascinating conversation. Uh-huh. And your lecture, I think, showed us an amazing view of the future.
Thank you.
Given the sheer scope now that you presented with in terms of opportunities to develop this, You've given us a diagram of the R&D company you've set up, but how are you approaching the sheer scale of opportunities?
The way we, and I'm very grateful for the university, we are trying to address that via the Li-Fi R&D Center, which is the world's first and only Li-Fi R&D Center, that we would like to address these different segments. But at the moment, we've just announced it in December last year, and we are now on a sort of a fundraising tour in order to get strategic partners into the Li-Fi Center. We would like to have strategic industry partners, and there's a number of discussions ongoing. We are hoping to get public interest in that as well, because we believe we can create quite a number of jobs here if we were spinning it out. And at the edge, at the cutting edge of it is all Pure Li-Fi, who's doing an excellent job in order to keep the commercial flag sort of at the forefront. So it's a multi-stage approach, pure Li-Fi, but then we need to have something very rocket solid at the back of it in order to address the different markets, because one company really can't address all the availability of opportunities that we have here. Yes, please.
Can we have a microphone at the front? And then after that, I think we have time for one more question.
What's the potential practical range of this? For example, could you reflect light from a satellite and make a truly global system? There is a publicly available satellite, I believe, called the Moon.
Thank you very much. This is my next research proposal. I don't know, I can't answer that. But it's, yes, you see the scale of opportunities. I think we need to bring it all together. Yes, but it's an interesting question.
One more question. There's a very keen hand from a gentleman in blue at the back, halfway down. That's it.
Hi, you mentioned the issue of carcinogens.
Of?
Carcinogens. Cancer.
Yes.
I imagine this is going to be a continuing concern. I'm just wondering whether you're taking any steps to show it is a safe medium, even in the R&D center.
You mean that Li-Fi, light, is a safe medium?
Yeah, because I imagine the World Health Organization is going to look at this if you're moving into a different spectrum.
Yes, but we need to agree that we are using a different part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So that what holds potentially, again, unproven for RF, wouldn't hold for light. Because it's light spectrum, it's the photons. It's not radio frequency signals that are emitted. And therefore, you would not be able to make a case in saying the radio frequency of a light source is potentially carcinogenic. Yeah, yeah. If you basically the spectrum gets the wavelengths get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, and ultraviolet already enters the skin, and that's why you get burns. But we are not using ultraviolet light. We're using visible light from an ordinary LED light bulb that you have at home to illuminate your home. Have you ever had anyone saying that you have concerns with your LED light bulb or your incandescent light bulbs? The only point I take is that we change the intensity at extremely high rates in the hundreds of megahertz. The human eye wouldn't be able to follow these changes, but there might be other effects we need to study. But that is subject to wider investigation, and I invite anyone in a medical environment to who is interested in studying that to do that with us. But our radio frequency signals, it's basically entirely orthogonal to what we do.
I need to bring our question and answer session to an end,
yes,
but
please.
I would point out that in exchange for staying for a drink at the end, you have an opportunity to ask Professor Haas questions at that point. And what I'd like to do now is introduce Dr. Tam Dalyell so that we can do our prize giving. Dr. Dalyell, of course, needs no introduction. He's been a columnist for The New Scientist in 1967, and I'm sure in that context you've all enjoyed his work. The day job, of course, was being a Labour MP in the House of Commons from 1962 to 2005, representing first of all West Lothian and then Linlithgow. I have to remind you that the Daily Mail described Dr. Dalyell as one of the most principled, honourable and dogged politicians of his generation, which is high praise indeed coming from anyone, and in particular from that source. His autobiography in 2011 is entitled The Importance of Being Awkward, and Dr. Dalyell will have a few comments before he presents his prize.
The University of Edinburgh has a tradition of welcoming scholars from Germany. Dr. Haas, you follow in the footsteps of Max Born, of Nicholas Kemmer, and many others, and you have enhanced that tradition in an absolutely riveting lecture. Many years ago, there was the idea that there should be a science festival. I was one of those, shall we say, in at the beginning. And we thought, many of us, maybe we'd get through the first year. The second year, if we were lucky. A third year, but beyond that, we thought it would peter out. It is to the credit of those who have organized the science festival. I don't know whether Simon Gage is here, but to say thank you to them for all the work that it's made possible. There's nothing I can usefully add to the lecture, other than to suggest a subject for another topic, namely, what Dr. Haas would do with the patent lawyers. I think I hear that you had 26 patents. Well, to sort out the difficulties of patent law, that really would be a challenge for the future. But in the meantime, it really is up to us to thank you very much indeed for a truly fascinating lecture. Thank you. It is my pleasure to hand over this prize in its golden envelope, golden Daxel.
Thank you very much.
This production is brought to you by the University of Edinburgh.